Hey Measuring Hero, Jay here. As we approach our 175th anniversary, we thought it would be fun to come back to the Optics Museum here in Oberkochen and tell a few curious stories that grace these halls. The first one we want to tell is a story about just how embedded quality is into the genes and DNA of our company. Folklore has it that Carl Zeiss himself was a bit of an impulsive man and would periodically walk the production floor. And if he saw a microscope that he felt was subpar, he would actually destroy it with a hammer. He didn't want his customers to have any subpar equipment. So right, wrong, or indifferent, that was our attention to quality. It was either perfect or it wouldn't go out the door. The next story we really want to try to talk about is something that has a little bit more of a quality assurance feel to it. So let's go have a look at our thickness gauge. Okay, in a previous blog, we talked about how in 1919, Zeiss started the metrology, what would become the metrology division. But actually, it was almost 30 years earlier, in 1890, when Ernst Abbe actually developed his comparator principle and created this gauge to counteract his comparator principle. This gauge and gauges like it were actually used internally for almost 30 years as part of our Zeiss production process. It was only until later where other companies saw what we were doing, asked for the same gauges, and we were enticed to create what is now the quality division. Now let's explore a topic that maybe is a little more accessible to all of us, and that's glasses. Me personally, I have Zeiss lenses with drive-safe technology. The drive-safe technology gives a slight blue hue to my glasses, but now let's talk about someone who also had a slight blue hue to his glasses. French Impressionist painter Claude Monet would periodically paint landscapes near his house in France. In order to tell this story, we have to talk a little bit about Monet's creative process. See, what he liked to do was clearly and precisely describe everything he sees. This is a problem because later on in life, he suffered from cataracts. It got so bad, actually it was a bilateral age-related cataract or nuclear sclerosis. By the time he was in his 60s in 1914, he complained that colors no longer had the intensity that they used to for him and reds looked really muddy. It got so bad again also that he actually had to label his paint tubes and keep strict discipline on how he mixed things so that even though he couldn't see the colors very well, he could try to remember what these things looked like. It was this period in his life where some of his paintings exhibited behavior like his brush strokes became broader and his colors were more brown and opaque. This is commensurate with the way you would see something if you had really bad cataract degradation. He had some corrective procedures, and in 1924, he visited a French optometrist named Jacques Maus, who presented him with Zeiss glasses. These Zeiss glasses had a particularly blue tint to help counteract the color issue that he was having. Monet himself described these glasses as perfect. After he used them for quite some time, he actually ended up revisiting some of the paintings he did before his corrections and touching them up. He even went so far as to destroy some of the paintings that he did over this time period. And of course, it was at this point where he began and completed work on his now famous water lily collection. Of course, if this were today, what we would do is take Zeiss lenses and actually implant them right into his eye, which was a technology that we developed much later. But of course, if it was much later, we could have corrected it in a much different way. So, hope you enjoyed a few stories from here in the Optics Museum as we celebrate our 175th anniversary. If you have a chance, go ahead and pop by whenever the world allows us. Until then, we'll see you soon. Stay safe, stay healthy. We'll see you next Thursday.